Next, research breakthroughs that seem almost like science fiction. It's all about growing human tissue and replacing or repairing muscles and someday even limbs. NewsHour science correspondent Miles O'Brien has our story. Be advised, some of the images are graphic.
I'm not sure when or why I thought it was a good idea to go for a bike ride on a 100-degree Texas afternoon with a 26-year-old Marine corporal. There I was, eating Isaias Hernandez dirt. No surprise, right? Well, take a look at his right thigh.
It looked like a chicken leg if you would take a bite out of it down to the bone.
It happened in Iraq in 2004. He was badly injured in an artillery attack on his convoy.
They patched it up because they said the only other option would be amputation because they couldn't just leave my leg on with a hole in it.
You need people who think quantitatively and qualitatively working together on problems like this.
What he did was reach out to this man. Dr. Steve Badalak is deputy director of the McGowan Institute for Regenerative Medicine at the University of Pittsburgh, where they are in the vanguard of a fast-moving field called tissue engineering. The goal? Grow tissue or even whole organs to repair damaged or diseased human bodies. Here they're using pig bladders to help grow human muscle. That's right, pig bladders. Turns out they're a good source of a fundamental biological building block known as the extracellular matrix.
So the matrix, the extracellular matrix, we call it ECM, is a sort of unique collection of structural and functional molecules that we then use as a therapeutic device to tell the body how to heal itself.
ECM is like a magnet and a manual for the stem cells inside us. Scientists are not sure why, but the matrix lures those malleable cells and gives them the cues they need to, in this case, morph into muscle.
The pillow.
We call this a powder pillow. Now,
the stem cells made their way to a pillow filled with powdered pig bladder matrix implanted in Corporal Hernandez's thigh in 2008. With the help of a lot of hard physical therapy from a very motivated Marine, they became muscle, a lot of muscle.
We never imagined we were going to get the robust response that we got. Now, he's replaced somewhere between 10% and 15% of his muscle mass at that site, but that muscle has gotten so strong that it's something like 50% of the strength of the quad.
Badalak is starting a larger human trial.
So using ECM, are you manufacturing body parts?
We're allowing the body to manufacture. We're setting the stage.
Laura Nicholson is doing just that in her lab at Yale University.
So we can buy parts.
We've reached a point where we can buy parts. For simple tissues, we can buy parts.
Nicholson hopes the spare arteries and veins she has grown will be tested in human trials soon. But she's not stopping there. She and her team are growing living, breathing replacement rat lungs that are genetically tailored for a rejection-free transplant because they are grown from the very cells of the recipient.
Otherwise, you'd be making a lung that would reject, just like the way lung transplants, you know, can reject now. So that's one of the major challenges with engineering a human lung is we're going to have to learn enough and employ enough stem cell biology so that we can take stem cells from the patient and coax them to become all of the different cell types that we need to make a lung.
The key to the coaxing process is our friend, the extracellular matrix. A matrix from a donor rat lung is bathed in cells that are genetically identical to the recipient. The cells marinate in an incubator called a bioreactor for 7 days, creating a lung that is a perfect genetic match for the recipient.
If they're not breathing, they don't develop, essentially.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, the rat lungs she has grown and transplanted so far are short-lived. They fail within hours because of blood clots. Nicholson isn't sure why. In fact, there's still a lot she is not sure of.
That matrix has an enormous number of cues, which we don't yet understand. But it directs the adhesion and the survival of cells within the lung. So even though we deliver a mixture of cells into the lung, we find that they all go to their proper locations.
It will be a long time before scientists will grow a breathing lung or a beating heart that could save a human life, but maybe not as long as you think.
When we started this, this was really still considered science fiction.
Anthony Atala is director of the Wake Forest Institute for Regenerative Medicine. He's been at it for more than 2 decades. Now he and his team are working on engineering more than 30 different tissues and organs, bladders and urethras, ears, skin, muscles, human liver tissue, and even a beating heart valve.
We know that naturally what a heart does is it beats on its own. So for us, the concept of recreating this in the laboratory is really nothing more than just recreating what nature already knows how to do.
Atella makes it sound easy, but of course it is not. Humans do have the ability to regenerate. Our skin, for example, turns over every 2 weeks or so. But over time, humans have also evolved to seal up disease and injuries with scars. It's good for keeping us alive after a trauma, but it prevents regeneration.
Just because we don't regenerate doesn't mean that we can't regenerate, it just means that we don't. And what we've done here is change the information in the cells at the wound site.
Dr. David Gardner of the University of California, Irvine, is trying to learn how to make humans better regenerators by studying nature's reigning regeneration champ, the salamander.
When you cut off a salamander's arm, you can cut it off at any level. So you can cut off fingers, you can cut it off at the wrist or the arm or the elbow or the shoulder. And whatever you cut off, that's always what grows back. It doesn't grow back more and it doesn't grow back less.
Gardner wonders how a human who has lost a limb might be able to recover like a salamander.
We do, in fact, have intrinsic regenerative abilities, just like the salamander does. It's just like two ends of the spectrum. We're not very good at regenerating complex organ structures like limbs or spinal cords and stuff like that.
But there is some promising research on that front as well. Look at this before and after video. It's the same paralyzed rat. Its ability to walk greatly improved after cells like these were implanted near its spinal cord injury. Eileen Anderson is an associate professor at the University of California, Irvine.
What we know is that when we transplant these cells, we can restore the ability of animals with spinal cord injury to step. We can restore their ability to be coordinated.
They are called neural stem cells. Stem cells that are ideally suited to repair the central nervous system.
So neural stem cells are more specialized?
Neural stem cells are more specialized. If you picture sort of a tree with embryonic stem cells at the trunk and all the specialized cells that are relative to different organs like the brain or the spleen or your bone marrow up in the branches, they become more and more specialized as you ascend.
Anderson and her team are working toward clinical trials to inject neural stem cells into humans with spinal cord injuries. Could these stem cells act like jumper cables? Maybe so.
Our hypothesis, our working plan here, is that that restoration of circuitry is what's yielding the recovery of function.
But you don't know for sure.
Nobody knows. How many things do you know in science that you know for sure? We think we know this because if we transplant cells and let animals recover to a stable baseline, and then we selectively ablate the human cells that we transplanted, we lose the functional recovery.
Francesco Clark is a big believer in the seemingly magical power of stem cells. In 2002, he dove into the shallow end of a pool.
And I was completely paralyzed in the blink of an eye.
At first, he could not move a muscle or even breathe on his own. Over time, he has steadily improved, thanks to a tough regimen of physical therapy and, he says, 3 stem cell treatments he received in China and Germany. They are not yet approved in the U.S.
So at this point, do you firmly believe there will be a cure for paralysis and that will derive out of stem cell treatments?
Absolutely. Yeah, there's no doubt in my mind. I mean, I'm talking, I'm breathing, I'm moving my arms, I'm wiggling around, I'm getting stronger. It's just, you want to say it's a matter of time, but it's not just time. There's a lot of effort that goes into it.
So how many years before we come back and see you walking around the house here?
I'm pushing for 5 years.
For real?
Yeah.
Go push, 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 push.
Like any Marine worth his salt, Isaias Hernandez is still pushing as well.
He's been such a warrior in more ways than one that he deserves to whatever we can give him. So we're going to do one more surgery on Corporal Hernandez. We're going to add more matrix and see if we can build more muscle for him and make him even better than he is today. So that's his future.
How are you feeling?
Good.
His goal for the future, a return to combat.
Why do you want to go back? want to finish up at least a full tour. If not, then just do everything to the best of my ability.
We dying yet?
Depends how long you want to ride for. Because these trails total, it's about 10 miles.
How's the leg?
Legs are good.
Let's do it.
I am living, exhausted proof he already has plenty of ability. Thanks in large part to an exploding field of science that may one day make us all live longer and stronger.
And it's Science Thursday on the NewsHour online. There we look at images of the giant asteroid Vesta captured by NASA's Dawn spacecraft and beamed back to Earth.